Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Those Turbulent Sons of Freedom, Ethan Allen's Green Mountain Boys and the American Revolution, by Christopher S. Wren, narrated by Peter Berkrot. Preface. They called themselves Green Mountain Boys, and George Washington did not trust them. He wanted their leader detained for interrogation. The other colonies balked at letting them join the United States of America. Britain plotted to exploit their discontent and cajole them back under the crown. Some of the harshest combat in the American Revolution fell to the homesteaders who settled New England's northern frontier. Defending shaky titles to the land they cleared, they made their own rules to create an independent republic called Vermont. Insubordination flowed through the blood of these Green Mountain boys and their kin. Driven by self-interest more than patriotism, they waged their own wars for independence, first against the neighboring colony of New York, which laid claim to their homes, and then against King George III in an insurgency across a boundless expanse of wilderness. Their disrespect of authority became a signature American trait that continues to manifest itself today. Choosing officers who led by example rather than rank, those turbulent sons of freedom, as one of Washington's toughest generals called them, excelled as light infantry rangers with tomahawks as well as muskets, which the best could fire as rapidly as 3 rounds per minute. The skirmish they started in this insignificant corner of the world, from London's perspective, would become a thread to unravel the tapestry of the ascendant British Empire, which had grown adept at ruling over restive subjects as far afield as India, French-speaking Canada, the Caribbean, and countless islands acquired in European wars and kept in thrall by redcoats and the Royal Navy. Missionaries were sent forth to propagate the gospel according to the Church of England. But this uprising in North America was launched by Yankee cousins at a distance who shared the same language, habits, and customs, even as they fussed about unequal trade and taxation without representation, unlike the loyal emigrants of Newfoundland and Nova Scotia. They offered Britain a wealth of valuable raw resources, from ship masts to potash and animal pelts, not to mention a dumping ground for convicts and other undesirables exiled to America. The hapless general Johnny Burgoyne was undone by what he called the most active and most rebellious race in Vermont, who would frustrate his plan to impose law and order on an unruly backwater of the British Empire. Vermont differed from not just England, but also the American colonies, and couldn't hold a candle to civilized cities like Philadelphia and New York. So here is what happened in this wild and neglected corner of the American Revolution, as told through a strapping trio of Green Mountain boys with outlaw bounties on their heads. Ethan Allen, his second cousin Seth Warner, and their companion Justice Sherwood. Allen, a charismatic rogue, would lose command of his Green Mountain boys, botch an invasion of Montreal, and be shipped overseas in chains for a public hanging. His cool-headed cousin, Seth Warner, would forge the raucous Green Mountain boys into a disciplined force whose hit-and-run tactics honed in strategic retreats helped save a broken, diseased American army from annihilation. And their friend Justice Sherwood, who opted for law and order over anarchy, would become their worst enemy as a master spy for Britain. Hindsight assures us that the American Revolution would succeed, but those who fought on both sides could not foretell the outcome. This is their story, too. 1. A land rush north. It was the lure of cheap land that drew pioneers like Ethan Allen, Seth Warner, and Justice Sherwood to leave Connecticut in one of the first great migrations in colonial New England. The virgin wilderness of the New Hampshire Grants, as Vermont was once called, attracted farmers from across Connecticut, Massachusetts, and New York, where their fathers' fields had become unaffordable or parceled among too many sons. Some were religious separatists rejecting the Calvinist dogmas and taxes imposed by established Protestant churches to follow the new light of a spiritual great awakening across New England. These pilgrim settlers brought their children and households on horseback through the woods from Massachusetts, following native trails too narrow for a cart. What limited their numbers were the hardships of daily life on the northern frontier. Winters ran wicked cold, with blinding blizzards and avalanches of ice. Blood-sucking gnats and mosquitoes infested the humid summers. Rattlesnakes coiled among the rocks. Wolves stalked the shadows. Hacking a plot from such dense forest demanded back-breaking toil from dawn to dusk. And a screaming catamount, the fiercest predator, could vault a split-rail fence and destroy a homesteader's livestock and livelihood in seconds. Misfits in colonial society, whether hellraisers, fugitives, or down on their luck like Ethan Allen, found an outlet for their frustrations in the vast backcountry of the Grants, so named for several million acres that New Hampshire's colonial governor, Benning Wentworth, granted for settlement between 1749 and 1764. The Crown encouraged governors like Wentworth to attract immigrants by offering them land to clear and cultivate. Land in 18th century America was wealth for the taking. In a colonial society without banks or negotiable credit, property was the route to social status in an ostensibly classless society. Speculators vied to buy and flip grants for profit. Where fortunes could be made, rascals and mischief followed. The hierarchy of self-interest extended upward to Governor Wentworth, who grew rich on the commissions and fees he charged, and the 500 prime acres he reserved for himself in each township he created. He would charter and sell off nearly 3 million acres in 135 such townships, from the Connecticut River to Lake Champlain, until he ran out of land. The first he named after himself, Bennington. Once the sun dropped below the rim of surrounding hills, Wentworth's paper townships plunged into pitch blackness, lit only by moonlight, the firefly flicker of campfires, and glowing cabin hearths. The journey was best undertaken in late winter, when the trammeled snow stayed frozen enough to make travel easier, before the ice thawed into a springtime morass of mud. Families who could afford them rode sleighs or pushed sleds up the frozen Connecticut River or Lake Champlain. They herded cattle and sheep through the valleys and foothills, passing up marginal tracts in expectation of better land ahead. Wives and children walked if there was no room in the oxcarts or sledges stuffed with farm and household implements. The more intrepid sallied forth to claim and clear their land, building a hovel habitable enough for their families to join them after the next winter. The earliest homes in the New Hampshire Grants looked nothing like the tidy farms left behind in Connecticut or Massachusetts. Logs were felled and notched to frame a cabin. More logs, split and hewed, made a floor. Bark covered the roof. Sticks plastered with clay became walls. Axes and augers were used to build a table, benches, and bedsteads. A large rock flanked by smaller stones formed the fireplace. The huts filled with smoke and leaked with rain, and were occupied before they were habitable. In winter, hefty logs would be fed into the fire and kept ablaze, not just for warmth, but also to keep away predators. Homesteaders slept on their unburned wood piles, swaddled in animal pelts. When the French and Indian War spilled into New England, its militias marched north to fight for the English king, hacking a road through the forests to Lake Champlain. The peace that followed France's surrender of Quebec in 1760 opened up the New Hampshire Grants as prime real estate. Veterans coming home from the war raved about fertile topsoil and trees so thick that it was hard to ride a horse among them. In the decade that followed Britain's treaty with France in 1763, the Grants swelled with nearly 18,000 new immigrants, including the children conceived during the long nights. Ethan Allen was almost 31 years old when he fled to the New Hampshire Grants around 1769, trailing failures, beset by lawsuits, and in a boring marriage. He had been born in northwestern Connecticut on January 10, 1738, but when he was 2, his father moved the family to Cornwall, a settlement that he helped start. Farmers toiled 6 days a week on the stony soil, coaxing out crops between pine stumps. Their wives spun clothes at home from local flax or wool. Families came together on Sunday to worship in an unheated meeting house, where Joseph Allen, a Church of England adherent, arranged for a preacher. He wanted Ethan, the eldest of his 8 children, to go to Yale, Connecticut's only college of higher learning, and scrimped to have him tutored by the local minister, a Yale alumnus. Joseph's sudden death in 1755 ended Ethan's formal education. A local tale remembered Ethan at 17, standing on his father's grave, challenging him to reveal whether there was an afterlife. Ethan started early to dispute religious matters. He did not disbelieve in God, but didn't much like him. He ridiculed the doctrines of original sin and the divinity of Jesus, taken as Holy Writ across New England. Ethan was 24 when he married Mary Brownson, who may have been the only woman who would have him. His bride was devout and a half dozen years older, but she came dowered with some land that her father parceled out among his 11 children. She likely couldn't read or write, for she signed their wedding certificate with a cross. Mary would weary of her husband's zest for argument and his contempt for religion. Ethan may have chafed at his wife's piety. Though he would sire 4 daughters and a son with her, he contrived ways to be absent more often than not. With a family to feed, he quit farming to work a marginal iron mine and forge in Salisbury, Connecticut. He had a violent temper and was charged with assaulting a neighbor who bought his stake in the forge. Profanity got him accused of public blasphemy. He was later ordered out of Northampton, Massachusetts, where he tried to run a lead mine after quarreling over religion in a tavern. His neighbors could not have been sorry to see him depart for the New Hampshire grants. Around 1769, Ethan Allen left his wife and 3 small children in the care of a brother in Massachusetts and set out into the grants beyond the Berkshire Hills to join his cousin, Remember Baker, hunting deer and selling their hides. Baker had fought the French and Indians as a teenage ranger before settling in the grants in 1764. Another cousin, Seth Warner, followed to explore the forest as an amateur botanist, collecting medicinal herbs for his father, the local doctor. Their companion, Justice Sherwood, arrived later in 1771. As life grew better for the homesteaders, so did the good life for Governor Wentworth, whose ingenuity in skimming a profit from his land grants made him one of the richest men in New England. Wentworth's success was a source of envy for New York's lieutenant governor, Cadwallader Colden, who deemed the unruly grants less loyal to the crown than New York, where Hudson River aristocrats followed the English custom of employing tenant sharecroppers to farm their estates. Homesteaders like Ethan Allen, Seth Warner, and Justice Sherwood expected to own what they tilled. New England's towns skewed toward subversive republican notions, Colden noticed, while New York modeled its government on the English Constitution. Can it then be good policy, he mused, to diminish the extent of jurisdiction in His Majesty's province of New York, to extend the power and influence of the others? So, Colden claimed the same property on behalf of New York in April 1765 and ordered settlers in the New Hampshire grants to pay New York a confirmation fee or face eviction. He sold off titles to 36,000 acres that Wentworth had already granted. The fees alone totaled more than $196,000, from which he pocketed $30,000, a fortune worth more than $1 million today, until he ran out of the watermark stationery required for legal transactions under Britain's Stamp Act. Colden knew that New York and New Hampshire's grants were divided by more than overlapping claims of geography. In colonial America, Yorkers and Yankees were bred in the bone to mistrust each other, as ardently as they disliked Virginians or Carolinians. Yorkers disparaged Yankees as vulgar and insolent, and thought their penchant for thrashing out differences in public verged on anarchy. Yankees were contemptuous of Yorkers as subservient and intolerant, and feared having their farms swallowed up by New York's feudal system of baronial manors. Ethan Allen would turn their resentments to his advantage. Governor Wentworth assured his customers that their deeds were legal. New York, he charged, had failed to populate a single township in the Grants. He was shoved out of office in 1767, after granting himself titles to another 65,000 acres, more than 100 square miles. The Board of Trade and Plantations, which supervised colonial commerce from London, accused him of selling land more for private gain than public good, and replaced him with his nephew. Never mind. For Benning Wentworth, at the age of 64, married his pretty housemaid, who was more than 4 decades younger. When he died 6 years later, she claimed his fortune. In June 1770, lawsuits to eject 9 titleholders from their farms around Bennington were bundled together for New York's highest court to decide. Ethan Allen was hired to gather proof of ownership for the lawyer defending their claims. He rode to New Hampshire's capital at Portsmouth, where he seized the chance to buy 500 acres from Governor Wentworth in a promising new township, named New Haven after Connecticut's, in the foothills east of Lake Champlain. He paid 25 Spanish dollars, about 5 cents an acre. New York's chancellor, Robert Livingston, heard the appeal of the New Hampshire title holders in Albany's City Hall on June 28, 1770. He ruled that the documents Ethan Allen provided were not legal and refused to let the jury look at them. His verdict rendered null and void every charter that Governor Wentworth had granted and relegated title holders to trespassers on their own farms. Ethan Allen was advised to settle on the best terms he could and loaned a horse and expense money to ride back to Bennington, where a surly crowd packed its Catamount Tavern. He exhorted them to fight the evictions. He knew as well as the settlers that they had no chance of surviving, much less prospering, in the Grants, if New York took title to land they had cleared and planted. Allen, in effect, was declaring war on New York, organizing his followers into committees of vigilance around the Grants, with himself as their colonel. His captains included cousins Remember Baker and Seth Warner. The vigilantes called themselves New Hampshire men, but when New York vilified them as the Bennington mob, Allen embraced that name. An early warning system evolved to stop New York from seizing land in the Grants. When New York authorities tried to evict a farmer from New Hampshire, Allen's vigilantes rode in to take back the property and mete out reprisals. Benjamin Spencer, New York's magistrate in one such township, Clarendon, knew who the troublemakers were. "One Ethan Allen has brought from Connecticut 12 or 15 of the most blackguard fellows he can get, double armed in order to protect him," he reported. "Unless the Bennington mob was stopped," he warned, "there had as good be an end of the government." Ethan Allen's tactics did not scare New York's royalist governor, William Tryon, who had crushed an earlier frontier rebellion as governor of North Carolina. He threatened to drive Allen's malcontents and the Grants into the Green Mountains. "I conceive it good policy to lodge large tracts of land in the hands of gentlemen of weight and consideration," he declared, and helped himself to 32,000 acres in the New Hampshire Grants. "They will naturally farm out their lands to tenants, a method which will ever create subordination, and counterpoise in some measure the general leveling spirit that so much prevails in some of His Majesty's governments." Ethan Allen gave his vigilantes the defiant name of Green Mountain Boys. On New Year's Day of 1772, they assembled at Seth Warner's homestead in Bennington, firing about his house, etc., and drinking good success to Governor Wentworth and all his Grants, and damning the Yorkers, according to an informer who heard that they were enlisting men and putting each recruit under oath to be true in maintaining the New Hampshire Grants. Governor Tryon boosted a reward for Ethan Allen's capture to £150, and £50 each for his cousins, Remember Baker and Seth Warner. The price on Ethan's head did not constrain him. On a bet, he walked into a tavern in Albany, New York, ordered a bowl of potent punch, and handed his wanted poster to the landlord, then drained the punch and swaggered out unchallenged. Tensions were running high when an armed posse from New York arrived on sleighs early one Sunday morning to capture Alan's cousin, Remember Baker, and burn down his cabin. They smashed the door in with axes. Baker's wife, Desire, tried to stop the abductors, who gashed her cheek and elbow with a sword. Their 12-year-old son was slashed when he tried to protect his mother. Baker, who had been asleep in the loft, jumped up naked from his bed and fought back with his axe. Outnumbered, he knocked out a board on his cabin roof and leapt into a snowdrift too deep to escape. A swinging cutlass hacked off his thumb. He was beaten senseless and tossed into a sleigh to be hauled back to Albany. From Arlington and nearby Bennington, a score of Green Mountain boys saddled up and gave chase. The attackers, taking them for a larger force, dumped Baker and fled back to New York. John Monroe, the New York magistrate who led the failed raid, identified 14 of the Green Mountain boys, among them Seth Warner and his friend Justice Sherwood, and clapped bounties on their heads. The next day, Sherwood returned with Warner to get Baker's musket back. Monroe grabbed the bridle of Warner's horse and ordered his arrest. Warner whipped out his cutlass, and with Sherwood covering his back, whacked Monroe so hard with the flat of the blade that the Yorker dropped to the ground. The blow, cushioned by his hat and thick mop of hair, left him stunned but alive. Warner and Sherwood trotted away. To enforce his strategy of intimidation, Ethan Allen led nearly 100 vigilantes into the town of Clarendon the next winter to punish the magistrate Benjamin Spencer, who hid from them overnight in the woods before fleeing to New York. They bashed in his door with a log and hacked his dog to pieces. Convening a mock court, Allen threatened to reduce every house to ashes and leave every inhabitant a corpse if his Green Mountain boys had to come back. "None but blockheads would purchase your farms and must be treated as such," he warned. For all his bluster, Allen knew how far to press his threats to advantage, for no one got killed. Instead, the Yorkers and their local collaborators were publicly thrashed with twigs of the wilderness, supple birch switches with the bite of a rawhide lash. Whipping was accepted punishment for petty criminals in the colonies. Ethan Allen's vigilantes and the Grants declared anyone with a magistrate's commission from New York to be their enemy. After one tipped off the authorities in New York City, the Green Mountain boys tied him to a tree and whipped him 200 times before jeering spectators. As soon as his bloody back was dressed, he was banished from the Grants with no time to collect his family and promised 500 more lashes if he returned. Even law-abiding Yorkers faced being driven off their land or having houses and crops damaged. One doctor advised his neighbors to buy their land titles from New York. Though armed with a brace of pistols, he was dragged to the Catamount Tavern, tied to a chair, and hoisted by rope above the two-story tavern next to a stuffed catamount atop the signpost, its teeth bared toward New York. He was left dangling for a couple of hours to the amusement of passers-by. By the following June, 1773, Tryon asked Frederick Haldimand, the Swiss-born general commanding British forces in New York, for regulars to put down the riots in the Grants. Haldimand refused, reasoning that New York's militia could suppress the lawbreakers. He would hear more from Ethan Allen and his mob. Tryon had the New York legislator pass a law in early 1774 prohibiting tumultuous and riotous assemblies by more than two people in the New Hampshire Grants. Anyone refusing to disperse could be shot. It amounted to a death warrant for Ethan Allen and his gang. He claimed that the bloody act was unconstitutional because the Grants had no elected representatives in the legislature. He dared Tryon to take on the Green Mountain Boys, as good a regiment of marksmen and scalpers as America can afford. Every Green Mountain boy was ordered to arm himself with a good musket, a pound of gunpowder, ball or buckshot, and a sharp tomahawk. They may condemn us to be hung for refusing to place our own necks in the halter, Ethan Allen scoffed. But how do the fools calculate to hang a Green Mountain boy before they take him? In the autumn of 1772, Remember Baker had led Ethan's youngest brother, Ira, on an exploration of Lake Champlain. Ira knew good land when he saw it, and urged his brothers to invest in property along the east coast of the big lake. For, as he explained, that was the country my soul delighted in, and where, at all events, I was determined to make settlement. The Allen brothers plunged into the rapacious sort of speculation that they professed to despise. With neither capital nor official contracts, Ethan and his brothers Ira, Heman, and Zimri joined their cousin Remember Baker, though not Seth Warner, to create the Onion River Land Company, which leveraged property that they didn't own to buy land that they couldn't afford and to which New York said they were not entitled. While Allen lobbied from Bennington, Ira Allen and Remember Baker returned to protect their investment. At the first waterfalls before the Onion River empties into Lake Champlain, they built a log blockhouse and stocked it with muskets and gunpowder to repel Yorkers with rival claims to the land. "We never walked out without at least a case of pistols," Ira boasted. The Onion River Land Company did not own the property, so Ethan set out to buy titles from the speculators in New York. In February 1773, Ethan and Ira Allen rode with Remember Baker down to White Plains, north of New York City, to buy as much land as a prominent Quaker real estate investor would sell them on extended credit. Ethan, Ira, and Remember, who were hunted in New York, assumed the disguise of British officers traveling from Canada to catch a ship for London. Their brother Heman booked them into a local tavern. When they settled their bill several days later, the landlord was startled to learn that his jolly guests in scarlet uniforms were Yankee outlaws. Over 3 days, the Allens contracted to buy more than 40,000 acres in the grants for less than 10 cents per acre. The brothers and Baker rode off to do business with another Quaker, who was appalled to see the pistols and swords that his visitors were carrying, but put them up anyway. The Quaker investors knew that their titles in the New Hampshire grants had become worthless in New York and were eager to dump a sour investment. The Allens tottered on the brink of bankruptcy as they scrambled to amass as much property as possible between Lake Champlain and the Green Mountains. Their Onion River Land Company could not even afford the basic fees that New York charged to confirm land purchases. Now they listed 45,000 acres of potential farmland available in the fertile floodplain near what is now Burlington, Vermont. "Land for sale on Winooski Intervale," they advertised in the Current newspaper in Connecticut. "Little or no timber growing thereon, except a few scattering buttonwood, elm, and butternut trees. The land rises from the intervale in graceful oval hills and spreads into swales of choice mowing ground." They recommended the local rivers' diversity of excellent fish, particularly salmon. Between 1773 and 1775, the Onion River Land Company accumulated a little more than 77,000 acres along Lake Champlain, but may have sold only 17,000 acres. The Allens and Remember could not agree on who owned what and dissolved their real estate speculation in March 1775. They resolved to sort out their differences a year later. But by then, Ethan Allen would be missing at sea aboard a British warship. Remember Baker would have his head cut off. Seth Warner and his Green Mountain boys would be fighting for their lives in the frozen wastes of Quebec. The Green Mountain boys relied upon a loose network of friends and neighbors, not all of whom shared Allen's hatred of New York. When Justice Sherwood arrived from Connecticut, he made friends with Seth Warner, who was working as a road surveyor in Bennington. Sherwood staked out his pitch in the foothills of Lake Champlain, a 50-acre plot in the new township of New Haven, where Ethan Allen had bought 500 acres from Governor Wentworth, and set to work clearing his patch of forest, girdling and burning the trees, pulling out roots, wrestling rocks into boundary walls. The other settlers elected him their equivalent of town clerk, entrusted with keeping New Haven's records. He was also invited to join a select group of 35 speculators, promised an additional 150 acres each, for the more speedy settlement of this town, if they cleared and cultivated at least 5 of the acres by the following June, 1775. His partners included Ethan and Ira Allen, Seth Warner, and other Green Mountain boys whose loyalty Ethan wanted to reward. Sherwood accumulated up to 1,600 acres in the grants. He built a snug log cabin for his new wife, Sarah, and planted an apple orchard to make hard cider, the most popular beverage. The fields he cleared grew hay to feed his livestock, and wheat and oats to support his family. Corn, potatoes, and green vegetables filled his garden. Unlike his neighbors in the Grants, where adult slavery would be declared illegal in 1777, Sherwood employed several African slaves. On the eve of the American Revolution, as many as 1 in 4 Connecticut households had slaves. Homesteaders like Sherwood had more in common with their Canadian neighbors than with the Yorkers. The best markets for their lumber, potash and grain, cattle and sheep, lay through Montreal, not New York. By 1771, the bulk of oaken barrel staves shipped from Quebec to Britain came from the Champlain Valley. Only the southwestern Grants lay closer to the Hudson River Valley and Albany than to Montreal. This geography would shape loyalties in the revolution to come. 2. Seizing Fort Ticonderoga. America's war for independence may have begun on the village greens of Lexington and Concord, Massachusetts, on April 19, 1775. But the first blood was spilled 5 weeks earlier, on the eastern rim of the New Hampshire Grants, when 10 protesters were gunned down in the name of King George in the Connecticut River town of Westminster. Ethan Allen was not there, but determined not to be left out, he dispatched 50 Green Mountain boys at a gallop across the Grants to join hundreds of local militiamen seeking revenge for what became infamous as the Westminster Massacre. His defiance of New York's authority had been slow to attract homesteaders who had settled along the Connecticut River, a hard day's ride from the base of Green Mountain Boys. Here was an opportunity to plunge his grudge fight with New York into the frothing cauldron of a larger revolution against Britain. Hard economic times and worthless money had left farmers across New England prey to creditors. The popular response in the New Hampshire Grants was to shut down the courts that New York maintained to dispense justice. On Sunday afternoon of March 12, 1775, 100 protesters gathered in Westminster to block the district court from opening on Monday. They were not bent on violence, though some picked up cudgels from a woodpile as they occupied the two-story clapboard courthouse. The sheriff appointed by New York arrived with a posse of 60 loyalists, armed with muskets, pistols, swords, and rocks. He ordered the rioters inside to disperse or be in hell before morning. The judge allowed them to stay until morning when he would hear their complaints. His Monday docket showed nothing more urgent than a murder. Many demonstrators left. The sheriff retired with his men to the local tavern. They lurched back to the courthouse an hour before midnight. The sheriff demanded entrance in the name of King George and was rebuffed. Drawing his sword, he climbed the stairs to the door. "God damn you, fire!" he ordered his posse, who shot into the dark courthouse, killing 2 protesters and wounding 8. In the chaos, most escaped through a side passage. The others trapped inside, including the wounded and suffering, were stuffed into 2 basement cells, a witness said, to bear the insane taunts of the victors and listen to their vile abuse. The jailer opened a small bar reserved for judges and lawyers and poured fresh shots for the sheriff's men, who resumed their brawling frolic. Daylight revealed the carnage. Musket and pistol balls pocked the oak timbers of the courthouse. Bloodstains smeared walls and stairs. The first corpse found was that of a young farmer from nearby Brattleboro. He had been shot in the head. A coroner's inquest ruled, of which wound he died and not otherwise. Pleas for help were answered from both sides of the Connecticut River, which divided New Hampshire from the Grants. Militiamen mustered, not just in Westminster, but also neighboring towns. By noon Tuesday, Westminster teemed with more than 400 trigger-itchy gunmen, some from as far away as Massachusetts. The witch hunt spread for New Yorkers and their loyalist friends. Westminster's roads were sealed off by supporters who, as one New York Journal reported, indiscriminately laid hold of all passengers against whom any of the party intimated the least suspicion. The mob, stimulated by their leaders to the utmost fury and revenge, breathed nothing but blood and slaughter against the unfortunate persons in their power. Ethan Allen's deputy, Robert Cochran, rode in with his Green Mountain boys and dared the crowd to collect a 50-pound reward posted by New York for his arrest. They carted the sheriff and seven of his posse off to jail in Massachusetts, where New York's Chief Justice arranged their release. The vigor with which militiamen poured into Westminster foretold the resistance that awaited British redcoats in Lexington and Concord 5 weeks later. The massacre frayed the last strands of tolerance toward New York's claim over the New Hampshire grants. On April 1, 1775, town elders in the Eastern grants resolved to petition King George to annex them to any government other than New York's or allow them to form their own. The law of self-preservation gave them the right they claimed to wholly renounce and resist the administration of the government and New York till such time as the lives and property of those inhabitants may be secured by all, or till such time as they can have the opportunity to lay their grievances before His Most Gracious Majesty. Ethan Allen had his own plans to rid the grants of New York. He flirted with seeking annexation by New Hampshire, then settled on a more brazen scheme to transform the grants into a separate royal colony. He found an influential ally in Philip Skeen, a retired British officer, who, like Ira Allen, saw the potential of Lake Champlain. Between 1763 and 1771, Skeen accumulated 29,000 acres on the lake's southern end, where he built a grand estate with its own sawmills, forge, and a boatyard. Since his property was purchased directly from London, he felt beholden to neither New York nor New Hampshire. He dreamed of governing a royal colony from his Fieldstone Manor at Skeensborough, now Whitehall, New York. He proposed to Ethan that the boundaries of the New Hampshire grants be extended as far west as Lake Ontario. Skeen sailed off to London, where he confirmed his royal appointment as the lieutenant governor of Ticonderoga and the satellite fortress at Crown Point, and surveyor of His Majesty's woods and forests along Lake Champlain. It remained only to persuade the locals to formally petition the king to make him their governor. Skeen's grand new title tripped him up when the ship sailing him back from England docked on June 7, 1775 in Philadelphia, as the Second Continental Congress was in session. The presumptive lieutenant governor of Ticonderoga and Crown Point was detained as a British agent after plans to raise a loyalist regiment were discovered among his effects. Popular fury over the British raids on Lexington and Concord demanded retaliation, and what more enticing target than Fort Ticonderoga? In a wilderness without roads, the star-shaped fortress was situated to dominate an inland waterway from Montreal to New York City, with land portages linking the St. Lawrence River and Lake Champlain to Lake George and the Hudson River. And Ticonderoga contained a trove of heavy artillery. In March 1775, the Massachusetts Provincial Congress sent a young lawyer, John Brown, north across ice-clogged Lake Champlain, to learn whether the Canadians and Indians would support their American neighbors if war broke out. Brown thought that only a preemptive action could stop British troops from striking south toward Boston. "One thing I must mention, to be kept a profound secret," Brown confided in a dispatch from Montreal. "The fort at Ticonderoga must be seized as soon as possible, should hostilities be committed by the king's troops. The people on the New Hampshire grants have engaged to do the business, and in my opinion are the most proper persons for the job." On April 28, 1775, a half-dozen prominent supporters in Connecticut siphoned 300 pounds from its treasury to finance an assault on Fort Ticonderoga and the nearby fortification at Crown Point. Governor Jonathan Trumbull had the money delivered to Ethan Allen and his Green Mountain boys. 2 days earlier, Massachusetts had authorized an applicant from Connecticut named Benedict Arnold to mount his own invasion, promising to supply him musket balls, flints, gunpowder, some horses, and £100 in cash. To earn his colonel's commission, Arnold was required to sign up to 400 recruits, deliver them to Fort Ticonderoga, and, as the Massachusetts Committee of Safety directed, use your best endeavors to reduce the same, taking possession of the cannon, mortars, stores, etc. upon the lake. Arnold was instructed to bring back any serviceable artillery and stores for the new Continental Army deployed at Cambridge, outside Boston. He had to procure provisions himself and present the bill to Massachusetts. Arnold had no military experience, having worked as a druggist, horse trader, and ship owner. Smart and ambitious, he would distinguish himself as one of Washington's best generals. A race was underway by Massachusetts and Connecticut to grab a crown jewel within a third colony of New York. For deniability, the sensitive mission was contracted out to freelancers, Benedict Arnold and Ethan Allen, each unaware of the other's plans. Arnold expected to retrieve 80 heavy cannon and 30 or more brass guns and mortars from Ticonderoga. But the fort itself was in a ruinous condition, he informed his Massachusetts patrons. The place could not hold out an hour against a vigorous onset. Fort Ticonderoga had indeed fallen on hard times since the French defeated Quebec in 1759. Its garrison had shrunk to several dozen British redcoats, some too old or ill for active duty, plus their families. The fort and barracks are in a most ruinous situation, confirmed their captain, who was grazing 11 cattle and 45 sheep along its ramparts. In May 1774, a British military engineer inspected Fort Ticonderoga and deemed only its stone barracks worth repairing. He proposed abandoning the fort and rebuilding another at Crown Point, which had burned down the year before in a fire caused by soldiers' wives boiling soap. 4 months after the inspection, a storage chamber inside Fort Ticonderoga caved in, burying supplies and ammunition. Ethan Allen had finished briefing his officers and Connecticut financiers at a local tavern when a stout stranger uniformed in blue burst in to announce that Massachusetts had picked him to capture Fort Ticonderoga. He introduced himself as Benedict Arnold, but Ethan refused to read the commission that he flaunted. Arnold, who had brought no troops, was stymied when the Green Mountain boys threatened to go home if they couldn't serve under their own officers. They arranged to regroup at a shallow inlet across Lake Champlain, just north of Fort Ticonderoga. 140 Green Mountain boys in farmers' clothes and 70-some volunteers from Massachusetts turned out, but no boats were waiting to ferry them across the lake. Ethan Allen, impatient with logistical details, had neglected to arrange transport. Only 83 troops could be shuttled across, packed into a scow whose oarsmen had been plied with whiskey and a borrowed rowboat. The impetuous Arnold jumped in and ordered Ethan Allen's men to follow, pitching through fierce squalls to safety on the lake's western shore. With dawn about to break, it was too late to fetch another contingent led by Seth Warner, who had to find their own way across the lake next day. Allen and Arnold bickered over who should lead the assault. Arnold had his commission from Massachusetts, but Allen had the Green Mountain boys. "What shall I do with the damned rascal? Shall I put him under guard?" Allen asked one of his men, who suggested that they enter Fort Ticonderoga side by side. Allen ordered Arnold to stay at his left hand, but Arnold rushed ahead anyway. The Green Mountain boys followed Ethan Allen through a wicket door left open in the main gate. A startled British sentry aimed, misfired, and fled, taking his pursuers to a small parade ground and stone barracks inside the slumbering fort. A second sentry lunged with a bayonet, but Allen's sword struck him. He begged for his life and pointed out the stairway to the quarters of the post commander. Arnold raced Allen up the wooden steps and banged on the door with his sword. A pale British officer appeared, breeches in hand, to ask by whose authority Allen and Arnold demanded his surrender. one of Alan's men heard Alan holler. Come out of that hole, you damned old rat! He was later credited with a more pungent salutation. Come out of there, you sons of British whores, or I'll smoke you out. Alan had banged on the wrong door. The British officer staring down his drawn blade was not the fort's captain, William Delaplace, but a recently arrived lieutenant, who had been awakened about 3:30 by whoops and cries of, No quarter! No quarter! He opened the door to see armed rabble pushing their way upstairs. The defenders in the barracks had been caught in their beds. It was over in 10 minutes. Benedict Arnold again presented his orders from Massachusetts. Ethan Allen insisted that Connecticut had authorized him to take the fort. If the British fired a single shot, Allen warned, no man, woman, or child would be left alive. Captain Delaplace emerged from his quarters to surrender the small garrison, which included 24 bewildered women and children. They didn't know that war had broken out in Massachusetts. Benedict Arnold offered to treat Delaplace like a gentleman if he handed over his sword and pistols, but never returned them. 10 miles to the north, Seth Warner ferried 100 Green Mountain boys across to take Crown Point and its meager garrison of 9 redcoats and 10 women and children. At the southern end of Lake Champlain, 30 more Green Mountain boys overran Skeensboro and seized Philip Skeen's small schooner moored in the bay. They invaded the crypt containing his deceased wife.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.